And that's when Walker said, I will never make another Texas Ranger movie. Okay? Okay. Of course, some of you may not know it. There really is no Texas Rangers anymore. They're a bunch of bureaucrats under the Department of Public Safety. They were changed over years ago. Anyway, the folks down there are started running low on supplies. There's some of us have been feeding them, sending things to them for the last 2 years. But we're trying to make a big run this time to get enough down there for those folks to survive with another year or two or whatever they want to do. It's up to them. It's free country, except only in that 40 acres for them. M&N Lowe is going to take a trailer out of this area down there. We're taking in donations at Longview at Dan Miller's office, Lawrence Savage's office in Frankston, Texas is taking in anything you can give, money, clothes, foods, hygiene supplies, anything like that. I'm sure you could get with Emmett or whatever, and we'll get it to them. We'll probably try to make a kind of a little convoy down there next week. They're very suspicious of a convoy pulling up there, though, I can say that. So you got to pull up there kind of easy. Because they do have guys running up and down the riverbanks in these little boats with these Ninja Turtle suits on and their automatic rifles. They just ride up and down. They don't do nothing. But they watch them anyway. So, anyway, if y'all would, help them out.
All right. We have started as the Texas Republic of going and visiting, and all the people in jail that we know of that are RT Texans, and we're working on it with every one of them, trying to get them out of the jails and stuff. And so this is what we're doing. So even the ones that got put into prison on the standoff out there in West Texas, we've gotten a hold of this man. We're not mad at him. He's in prison. I wouldn't want to be there. And so anyway, what we've done is we started dialogue with him. Now he's come back on the side where he should be been all along. He got off out there chasing money, and that's what got him in trouble. And so anyway, in all this, do you have questions?
Yes. Absolutely.
Okay. How long does the process take before you know your name has been cleared of the debt? When you write that bond, it's clear of the debt. The rest of it does not matter. You've cleared your name by writing the bond. Now, let me tell you one trick on the bond. When you do the instructions, always end it up with, place this bond against the debt of the United States. What has been happening is these bonds have been given to the Federal Reserve System, who then turns them into cash, which places a country or the United States into further debt. This is where it's all coming from. And so the bonds are good. When you sign them, they're good. And so accept it that what you did is good. Don't question what you've done. You see, there are no laws telling you what you can do and what you can't do. When you do it, it's done. And stick with that.
What's that phrase again? Place,
huh?
Place this bond against the debt.
Against the debt of the United States. If you don't do that, and you start sending these bonds to the Secretary of Treasury, John Snow, and this is a change in them. Start sending them to the Secretary of Treasury, John Snow, 1500. Pennsylvania Avenue, Northwest, Washington, D.C., 20220. And then place down there to put this against the debt of the United States of America.
Small U, right? Small U?
Yeah. Small U, Small United States of America. Once bond is sent out for credit card company, if it is turned over to a collection agency, what steps do you take then? I just went over them tonight. I don't know who you are. Did not correspond with you. You've got to be a third-party debt collector. I don't deal with third-party debt collectors. If you think you're representing me, you're fired. And anytime anyone calls you at home and they start harassing you at home, don't get upset. Just say, sir, or ma'am, what'd you say your name was? And if they tell you, say, if they don't tell you, say, well, I don't talk to anybody on the phone about my business. You're fired. If they tell you the name, say it, call their name and say, you're now fired. Don't call me anymore. And they'll hang up. And so that's all you do. They're going to try to get you to come back and say, well, I was wrong in doing that. Don't ever tell anyone when you do these things. Don't ever, somebody comes to you and says something to you, take that bond and, you know, and do away with it. The instant you do that, they're going to charge you with filing a fraudulent document. It's a good document as long as you keep it there. But don't take it away because you've admitted that you did it. They played that trick for years. Go tell this guy if he'll take that lien off this judge. And that I sent you a copy of that thing about that lien that one character's doing from prison. He's got them all upset. Why would they be upset if there wasn't anything lawful or attaching to them? Why would it bother them? They'd just laugh at it and throw it in the trash can, wouldn't it? What happens is, though, they go out and start trying to buy goods, and their wives go shopping at Saks Fifth Avenue, and they say, hey, you don't have any money in your account. I can't do that. I can't cash this. That's when it starts getting to them. And then they try to go to this judge, and he'd put a big lien on her, and so guess what? She had to recuse herself out of the case. So you have to understand that what you're doing is good. And whatever you do, if as long as it's right, do it.
Do we need to send our old bonds to Johnstone, the ones we sent a while back? No.
That's fine where you did them. But now send them to them and tell them you want this to go against the debt of the United States. No. I'm talking about the bonds you write against traffic tickets or anything else. That's where you send them to. Are you aware that as of about 4 weeks ago, the IRS is returning $500 penalties to anyone who files a 1041? What do you do with it? Accept it and return to you for closure. Send me penalty things all day long. But I haven't had anyone tell me that, but anyway, I do know that they're getting a lot of guarantee you nobody, none of them are signed. The IRS, this has been done all over the country. They first put out they weren't going to allow any more 1041s to be filed. Then they come out, I guess they're coming out with this now. The IRS did publish an announcement about the end of March that they would be returning all 1041 forms with a frivolous filing penalty. This sounds like making a legal determination. That's exactly what it is. And that's what you write back to them. You know, I'm capable of handling my own affairs. You're fired. I don't want you making a legal determination for me. So exactly. Ed says they want you to send them another bond, and that's true. Because they're stealing them and using them. Send them another bond, you've written the same bond for the same amount, and they take it. What is the next step to take when the bond does not work for tax levy on wages? The thing that that we've been doing, and it's been working, is writing the 1041 And then file. You're going to have to come to a conclusion with your company. Or do you want to work for them for nothing? See, that's the first decision you have to make. If I lose everything, I haven't lost anything because all they're paying me is $525 a month. Would you want to work for that? If you quit there and go to work somewhere else, what's going to happen? They're going to follow you there, aren't they? So somewhere you're going to have to stand up and fight. Start placing a commercial lien on the company. See, start the process. It's in the book, 21, 15, 5 days. Give them notice. And then tell them each time, this is what you did. Did not give you permission to take my money. You want to take me into court? That's fine, but you haven't done that, and you have no lawful way to be taking that money. Now, the way you can correct that is quit taking my money and give me back what you've taken. Third thing is, I'm going to place a commercial lien on your company. And always in there when you're writing to them, tell them, I enjoy working here. I am not upset about working here. But you're taking something that is mine. And you have no authority because I have not given you permission to do so. And so at that point, that's what you have to come to. It's the only way that I found I did it. I went through it. So I'm not up here telling you something that I haven't done. It was hard. You get you somebody to help you out during that time. And if you've got a wife or a husband and they're working, then they can help out during that time. You got all this ammunition to take care of your credit cards and stuff, so, you know, that'll knock you. But you have to go in and fight with them and then place a lien on their company. It's just the way it is. And I went through that. I wrote the three letters. I was living on $525 a month. The good thing, I was working for a food company. And so I got to go into the grocery stores, and I wrote me credits in there for food. Come lunchtime, I got some of their product off the shelf, wrote a credit to the store, and went upstairs and ate it. They allowed it. It wasn't something I was doing underhanded. I did it all the time. I picked up sometimes 5 and 6 banana crates full of stuff because you damage a box or you damage, you know, something, that, and they pull it off the shelf, and the companies give them credit for it, and so... I had to write credits. I used to eat very well. And it was ours to take home. And so that's how we survived. And the company furnished me a car and gas, so I didn't have to buy gas. And I never missed a rent payment. I was $400 a month. And so I had $125 to live on. But it ate some potatoes, raw potatoes sometimes. You know, and things like that. But you learn to survive. But in the end, what happened was I filed against the IRS, took them into bankruptcy court, and then told them you show me where the credit contract is. Now they will forget. They said, well, I guess we'll have to let the judge decide this. And so I told the judge, maybe you can tell me where the contract. And I said, you discharge this thing. Or you wasn't discharged, we didn't know that then, but I said dismiss it with prejudice. And he signed it, gave it to me. So it does come out in the end, but you have to fight it through. If you don't, you go to work somewhere else. Otherwise, you're going to have to go out and find different things to do that people pay you in some other way other than getting your Social Security number. Because they're going to come after you again. But during that time, you can fight the IRS. I filed a 1041 pay tax from 1996 and subsequently filed an amended form 1040X showing zero income, requested a refund. The IRS never responded to the 1040X. On June the 9th, 2003, I received a letter from the IRS at Ogden stating they had determined that the 1040X was a frivolous document. Who are they to make a legal determination for you? And that I could be charged a $500 penalty under something. To avoid the penalty, they said, I could sign a form. What are they saying now? Let me represent you. And I could sign a form 2297 and form 3363 within 30 days. is titled Waiver of Statutory Notice Notification of Claim Disallowance. It states, I waive the requirement under Internal Revenue Section so-and-so that a notice of claim disallowance be sent to me by a certified or registered mail for the claims for a credit or refund shown in column D below. Form 3363 is titled Acceptance of Proposal Disallowance of Claim for Credit or Credit. States, I accepted the proposal of the IRS to disallow the claims to the extent described above. This means only that I do not want the service to consider the claims. In other words, we want you to take that 1040X off. It does not waive my right to file suit on the disallowance. My feeling is they're trying to trick me into signing documents. They may trap me later. What's your... Yeah, they are. They are trying, and the thing I'd write back to them is what I'm telling you all the time. It's accepted and as true, and I'm returning it to you as true. And then if you got any names of that people, put the district director or the director of that, wherever it is, and say, I am competent to handle my own affairs, and you're hereby fired, and send it back to them. You see, all they're trying to do is contract you in to letting them represent you. That's all this letter's about. Goodness. From Ron William Bond, regarding the use of bonds, are there certain words or wording that needs to be included in the bond itself? Exactly the way the bond's written up. Don't vary from that. Is there a particular format, meaning art form, size? No. It's your bond. You want to put it on that paper, that bond paper they call it, put it on the bond paper. It's your bond. You want to write it on a... I won't say that. I'll write it on a brown paper bag. Write it on a brown paper bag and send it to them. It's your bond. It's your bond. They cannot tell you how to write the bond. To make it stand out more. That's up to you. You make it stand out, draw red lines on it, whatever you want to do. It's your bond. But don't change the wording. I know that bonds can be sent by using regular typing paper, but additionally, is there a particular type of paper that can be used for the bond? Yeah, they have bond paper. It's real thick, and it has written on there bond. You can see the bond on it, and you can put it in the machine, and it'll print that bond out on it. But it's worth no more than the other paper. It's just bond paper. It costs you more. How much is paper worth? How much does it weigh? Very little. How much is this piece of paper worth? See, everything is by promise to pay. What is a Federal Reserve note worth? Nothing. It's a promise to pay. Now, it can get you food and do all this other stuff, but it's a promise to pay. Everything in this system is a promise to pay. On these things, when they say, make them up a bond, this IRS thing, make them a bond and send them to them. And leave it open. I know the bonds can be sent by using, okay. Regarding the person to whom the bond is sent, can such person be an artificial entity, or does a person have to be a human being? Cannot be a human being. Can be a living, cannot be a living soul. He has to be a corporation or a created fiction. Cannot be a living soul. Can't do it. It is to take care of debt. It is not to buy things with. I know people are trying to do that, but that, I'm not going to tell you what might happen. Notice is a requisite to one process, due process at law. If the Bible is the law, then every single American has already had notice and due process. In that every single American has passed notes that say, where he lived, he believed to say, in God we trust. And because the Gideon's Association, from their Bible, in every motel and hotel room in America, I'll bet there's not one person in this room or in Dallas County that can truthfully say they have not had notice of the law, i.e. the Holy Bible. That is truth. But you don't need what I tell you. It's what comes out of you. If you're going to try to use a third party in it, and you make God a third party in this, you don't use him as who he is. He's not a third party to anything. He's either speaking or you're speaking, one or the other. So all I'm telling you is when you bring in, you know, people get into an argument about the Bible, or they get into an argument about their religion, and the first thing somebody does is go get the third party. They get the Bible and they say, it says right here. Well, that guy looks at it and says, no, it says this to me. Now there's an argument, isn't there? You have to live your faith. Can't go around making somebody else do something with a third party. You live your faith, they might look at you and say, hey, you know, something different about him. You know, then when they ask you, you can tell you. But anyway, don't get it that I've studied the Bible for years, and I finally learned. It finally came to me one day, and he said, you know, won't you put that down? All you're doing is arguing scriptures, and I'll tell you what it's talking about. It's all we do with it is we argue. Isn't that right? And what does he say? Quickly agree with your adversary. Oh, that's the way you believe? Okay. Why? Because you get into a big argument after that. That's why you say so thing, I accept as true. And I'm returning it as true. Now there's no argument, no thing, and it melts away. Start an argument, and as wrote on the email the other day about the Supreme Court being a corporate court. And guess what? They wrote back and they said, what do you mean by corporate court? This is where they were coming from. And so I explained to them. But should the bond be notarized? No. What is the time period after delivery date should I allow for having the bond accepted? When you write it, it's accepted. On the bond, if they do, they're dishonoring. And you can't dishonor in commerce. They've dishonored your presentment. So they cannot dishonor your presentment. It's either honor or dishonor in commerce. Can be nothing else. And so if you honor something by accepting it, then it belongs to you. If they do not honor your bond, then they've dishonored it and they've committed a commercial crime in commerce. How do I know that the bond is accepted? When you write it. Don't write it if you don't think it's going to be accepted. It's your bond. Don't write anything. Don't declare anything unless you want to do it. If you do it, then believe it's going to do what you said. Otherwise, don't write it. In the event the bond is tactically accepted by a person, do I then send the letter to that person confirming? No. Just let it go. Once you write the bond, go on to something else. If you get any response back to it, deal with the response. But see, we're always used to, the judge pronounced sentence, I go to jail. That ends it. You know, that's what ends the thing. We're always looking to an end or for someone to verify what we've done. Why would you want somebody else to verify it? If you're going to let me verify it, then you let that guy that you're sending it to verify it. And he'll tell you it's not any good. I may say it looks good to me. But do your own self. You understand, I'm just telling you, until you recognize and realize your sovereignty, you're going to keep having these questions. What should I do if they, who are they? They is this character that snuck into your bedroom. Matrix. He's a matrix. You're the sovereign. Why would you care what they think? I tell people, the reason we get in court so much, we go in there, instead of listening, we start trying to understand what they're saying. And when you do that, you're lost. You're not thinking about what you're going to say. You're not sitting there writing down what you're going to say when it comes your time to talk. And when you get up, you just go totally, it freezes you. Because now you've listened to that attorney say, if this man does that, we're going to throw him, Your Honor, we're going to ask for 30 years in jail for him. Why should you care what he says? Is he God? Is he the one that proclaims stuff? If a judge does not honor a bond for a case, did you make the judge the bond out to him? Huh? All right, then make it out. You made it out to the judge? You have some interesting experiences with these things, but make them out to, and send a copy to the sheriff. And I've had two or three of them try to send them back. Why? It totally hamstrings them. They cannot do anything, and they don't want to get a hold of it. When that judge says he don't accept it, he can't not accept it. He can tell you he didn't accept it and get you to believe it. Huh? He isn't. He is a fiction. All judges are fictions. Everybody in that courtroom, let me tell you something. Everybody in the courtroom is a fiction. They all represent a corporation or work for the corporation. They're a fiction. They don't exist. You're the only one in there who is a living soul. And when you get up and state it, who is the only competent person in that courtroom? You are. Once you do it, anybody works for a corporation you can send them to. But they're all addressed to people, agents for the plaintiff. But if you get a response back and say your bond's not any good, you write back, accepted as true, and return to you as true for closure and discharge, see attached bond, and put a copy of the bond back on there and send it back to him. I'm telling you, it runs them nuts. And let me tell you something. There probably is maybe 80, 90 people in here. This is all over the country. I mean, big time. It is not just here. Larry can tell you a number of tapes and things he's sending out all over the country. You know, it's got to be helping somebody or nobody would want it. And so I'm as best I know the truth, I'm telling you. I don't think you've ever gone and listened to anybody that tells you this, these things. Because I've never sought codes, rules, and regulations to live by. And so, as a result, I never looked in law books and stuff. A lot of people research, and I'm not knocking researchers. Some people are researchers, and they're for a reason. But not all people are researchers. I am a leech off the researchers. They put out something, and I read it, and I say, hey, look here, and I take that out of there, and I go with it. All of this has come from many, many, many people, but it's all over the country. I had people flying from Canada and Washington State last Sunday. Spent all day with them. They came in from Nebraska, 7 or 8 of them. Spent all day with them. Came in from Louisiana. Came in from, it's more from, come down to the Houston meeting. Mississippi, they came down here. Tennessee. I get calls from New York. And then I get a call from a lady in Connecticut. Please send me your book. I think I'm the only one up here that knows there's something wrong. Every one of these other people got their head in the sand. See? But it's going out everywhere. Michigan, I mean, every state you can think of. So we're not the only ones. You know, it's like old Elijah. He says he went off and hid in the cage after he did what he did, and he came to him and said, what are you doing here? Well, you don't want to know that woman Jezebel. I'm the only one left. He said, don't pride yourself on that. I got 7,000 that I've saved to myself, so don't pride yourself. See, so we're not the only ones. What y'all are doing is giving the format for this to go out all over the world. It's literally going everywhere. And I can't tell you, from Arizona, saved the lady's house out there, Colorado. Now that lady, see what happens is you get someone who's really knowledgeable about property and all this other, and she was, and they came after her house. She did this process, showed up at the meeting, none of them showed up. She simply took them this competency document and presented it to their face. Here, you're served. No one. And it was in the treasury, the county treasurer's office of that county. He was the trustee who was giving her land away. He said, we're going to sell your land and...